signs in the heavens and signs in the earth, nation rising up against nation, and man's love waxing cold. At the center, the two branches of Israel coming together as one, all pointing to the return of the great king, soon, but not yet. Prepare the Way is a program which looks at issues of the day that mainstream media ignores. We face the truth head-on in a world that is determined to tear itself apart. Leading the discussion today is your host, author Daniel Holdings. Phone lines will be open later in the program so you can join the discussion. Now let's prepare the way.
Well, good evening, Hebrew Nation. This is your host, Daniel Holdings, and you are listening to Prepare the Way. We have an information-packed hour with you as I speak with expert Gil Broussard about Planet X. But before we get to that, a brief programming note. Of late, I know that many of you have wanted to call in and have a dialogue with me. However, this show is pre-recorded, and the reason for that, obviously, is because my guest needed to be available now and not at the normal airing time of the show. We will hopefully get to do a live broadcast very soon. Now, before we get started, you need to know something. My website is www.danielholdings.com. The reason I tell you that is because my guest information is on that website. So if you are by your computer, you need to click on your little mouse there and open up that website so that you can begin to peruse the information that Gil has put on the website, because it is pertinent to the discussion that we are having, and you will find it difficult to follow it. So please take the time to go to the website and to bring it up and take a look at the information so that you can follow the discussion. Now, my guest this evening is Gil Broussard. Gil is out of south of Lafayette, Louisiana. He's a Louisiana boy, and he's an independent researcher, an amateur astronomer, and he is a tenacious individual. He was a former engineer in the oil and gas industry that's given him the ability and access to visit many places in the world, as well as talk to individuals that you and I may never get to talk to. So it is with that background that I bring on to you today our guest, Gil Broussard. Gil, welcome to Prepare the Way.
Well, thank you. Thank you for having me. Yes.
You're welcome. We are very excited. You know, Gil, one of the things that I've tried to do in my writing, and I, you know, my listeners know that I am an author and that I write fiction thrillers. And one of the things in my last book that I actually happened to mention was Planet X. But Planet X actually goes by many different names. And so I was very excited when you and I had the opportunity to talk and to get you on the air for our listeners, because audience, the show is Prepare the Way, as you know. And we talk about those things that are coming upon the earth in preparation for our coming Messiah, the second coming of our Messiah. So it is important that we look at these things with eyes wide open. Some of the things that Gil will talk about today will absolutely blow you away. But audience, I challenge you, look at the information, look at the evidence, look at the data before you make up your mind. Because it is astounding the kind of things that this man has to say, and it is my pleasure to have him on the show this evening. Now, Gil, what is Planet X, and what other names does it go by?
Well, it goes by probably 80 different names throughout different cultures. You've heard it as either Zeus or Jupiter or Baal or Nibiru and several other ones. And that's associated with the time and culture. That's the only reason why the name is changed.
But you know, when you talk about Planet X, you actually don't call it Planet X. What do you call it?
I call it Planet 7X because we know the size now. And secondly, it's a separated data on where the information is coming from. There's some people that are have a story, I call it, of Planet X, but there's no data backing it that I could find. It started really from a circular reasoning that one person said it, then it's misrepeated. But when you go back to find the root and where the evidence is and the data, it's lacking. And so I was a hardened skeptic pretty much on the whole topic. For about a year and a half, there was no evidence backing any. There was threads of truth, it sounded like, from some of the storylines of the ancient people's accounts. But that's about as much as I would give it at the point. There was no evidence to say when, the size, any of this, until I found my own evidence pertaining to that.
So that's what thrust you on this journey. How long have you been researching Planet X, 7X?
3.5 years.
3.5 years.
After I found some hard evidence, then that caused me to do a very deep study in it.
Well, in audience, so you know, I've done some research as well, obviously, for my books. However, this man has the inside skinny, as they say, on what is going on, and we're going to delve into that in just a moment. But before we do that, Gil, we need to set some information up for the listeners, some foundation, so that they understand what we are talking about. Now, I have heard it said that Planet X's or Nibirus or the Destroyer or Wormwood, however you want to call it, many names, as you said, it goes by, that the orbit of it around the sun is A, elliptical, and B, that it is a 3,600-year orbit or something like that. So what exactly is an elliptical orbit, and what do you think that the orbit actually is?
Planetary bodies normally have a elliptical orbit, but it's more in a circular shape around the star. Slender or very tight elliptical orbits are usually pertaining to comets or asteroids or something similar to that. But this object that we're talking about for the first time, this is going to be redefining some of our definitions in astronomy. This is a planet-sized object that has a very slender elliptical orbit, roughly about 150 days apart on its entry and exit, between 150 and 152. The modern time frame would be about 152 days. And that's what's so astounding. Without the records, the Asians in the year 1054, that they actually saw the object and gave us enough accurate data that we could actually plot it. So that started it off.
So I want to get to that data in just a few minutes. But for the audience's sake, when it comes to you don't believe that the orbit around in our solar system around the sun is 3,600 years, do you?
No, that's where there's no data actually backing that. Because when you're dealing with ancient languages, keep in mind that zeros were misimplied. So to get 3,600 years, you got quite a few zeros in there that would indicate that 3,600 year orbit are found to be false. I think it mostly started with Stichen. The ancient Sumerians had a unit of 60. And so if you would have did 60 times 60, you'd have 3,600. But if you would have multiplied 60 times 6, it's 360, which some of it's, this has a erratic orbit if it's not hitting or bumping into things. But for the most part, it has somewhat of a 360-year orbit.
Okay,
in general.
Let's define terms here for the audience, because many people in the audience may not know about Planet X. They probably read about Wormwood in the Bible. However, they may not know about Planet X and the history behind it and the discussion from the various so-called experts. Who is Stichen? What is Stichen?
I'm not quite sure what his title was, but he interpreted some ancient clay tablets.
Sumerian text, was it not?
Right. Sumerian text from it was clay. It was clay tablets. But when you're dealing with ancient language, zeros are implied again. And so evidence is when you can start with text that is qualified by multiple people who interpret it, saying this is what it says. So then your basis is sound. Whatever conclude for that. No one backed up Stichen's misinterpretations who are able to read the Sumerian text.
The point is that Stichen, I forget his name, Carl Stichen? Carl Stichen was, he's an occultist. But there have been numerous individuals that have taken his information and ran with it. The circular reasoning, just as you mentioned a little bit ago. And this is why I bring this up, because if you put junk into a computer, you'll get junk out of a computer. So it's really important.
Correct.
we start with a sound foundation, and that's why I don't want to delve too long into Stichen, but that's why, audience, we needed to go there. So you know who this person is, where some of this, there are various experts out there that are talking about it. One of the people that I found most credible is, you're listening to him now, Gil Broussard, because of the information where the information is that he has taken it from. So this is really, really important, and that's why we are talking about these things that we are. So with that said, Gil, there are, you said that it was a 360-year orbit, you believed. So why do you say that biblical events do you see in Scripture that point to a associated heavenly body entering in our solar system?
Well, we have multiple, probably close to 12. One of them, what caught my attention was in two main stories. Noah's flood states an event that's 150 days apart. And if you listen closely to it, in the description, the way the floodgates of heaven opened up, that's not a normal rain. And at the end of it, at 150 days, there was a great wind that passed over the water before he saw the water to recede. There was two major events, 150 days apart. Well, that's also qualified in Revelation. It talks about these two events, CO6 and 7, And it says 5 months they'll wish death, but death will not come. Well, 5 months in a biblical term and 150 days is equal, just about equal. It could be 150 to 152 days. And I kind of look at that through astronomy as possibly a meteor shower of the entry and an exit point of an object that's on the planetary plane of Earth that's crossing Earth's path twice. So if that assumption, if we go with that, now we have three fixed points, not two, because the other fixed point is the sun. So that puts an object that's exactly on the planetary plane of Earth for it to cross Earth's path 5 months apart at for such an event.
Right.
And then what other qualifiers we have is, if you look at Yeshua's sacrifice, well, there was a 3 hours of darkness that even outside texts and other books says the whole earth was darkened.
And why is that significant? I mean, people say, well, it could have been an eclipse of the sun.
Because mainly Passover is held on a full moon.
Right.
You cannot have eclipse of the sun in a full moon state.
That's right.
The moon has to be 180 degrees on the opposite side of Earth in a new moon state to block the sun.
Well, and on top of that, I don't ever recall an eclipse lasting for 3 hours.
Correct. An eclipse only lasts around 7.3 minutes at max. And the biblical and the outside text says both the moon and the sun were eclipsed. You have a double eclipse. You cannot have a double eclipse at the same time because one causes the other. You can only have one at a time. So it's actually defining through, if you look at it through astronomy eyes, it's defining a third object that's many times larger. And throughout other events, we came out and that's how we got the object being anywhere between 6.5 to 7.5 times the diameter of Earth that causes a 3 hour eclipse.
Wow. Audience, this is the first time I've heard this. One thing I want to go back to very quickly, Gil. People have said that Nibiru was a brown dwarf star. That is a star, audience, that has a fire, that doesn't have a hydrogen reaction. So, but it's very heavy in gravity and mass. Other people have said it was a planet. Other people said it was just a large comet. You think it is what exactly, Gil?
Well, there's some areas in astronomy that I don't exactly agree with. I'm taking the newer data that's coming out from the physics community, and that is starting to explain things in a different light that's beginning to be proven out. We don't have a full understanding of the sun, that it takes in plasma from the, you know, from the north and south, and it radiates down the middle of the belt where all of the planets are. And before that, astronomers used to say that Jupiter was possibly it didn't have enough mass to become a sun, that it had the characteristics. Well, I disagree with that, with the new findings of physics, that Jupiter is always a planet, and it always will be, and that's not the same makeup as a sun. And so the terminology of a brown dwarf is along the same lines as Jupiter, that they believe that it's just doesn't have enough mass to ignite. And that doesn't bear out in evidence. What it is actually just a planet of a sizable size. And it's not a gaseous, it's more of a solid body, because I can point to where Ceres was destroyed by it.
Right. And I want to get into that in the next half hour, but let's continue with the audience. I wanted to go back to this because it's an important point. If you have heard about Nibiru or Planet X, you've heard several different theories, and I wanted to make sure that we understood where Gil was coming from. Now, Gil, you were talking about biblical events that are associated with the arrival of this heavenly body. You mentioned the flood, and you also mentioned Yeshua's crucifixion. What other kind of biblical events have you seen in Scripture that lead you to believe that this 360-year arrival by this heavenly body had affected Earth in some way, shape, or form?
I'll rattle it off for you in a short period of time here. That started with Noah's flood is one of the events. Then it was the Tower of Babel, which happened at the same time as Solomon and Gomorrah.
Now, this is interesting. If you could pause right there for me, something about that I read in the book was what happened to the Tower of Babel, So tell me exactly what happened to the Tower of Babel. What did you find?
Yes, Tower of Babel, when we look at outside text in the Talmud, has some historical texts that describe the destruction of the Tower of Babel. And it says that the top was burned, the lower section sank into the sand, and it was only the middle section left for the world to see as it was destroyed. Well, you can go to Google Earth and look at the ancient city of Babylon and look south of that, because ancient city of Babylon as it is today, that's the mid-kingdom. And we're talking about the ancient kingdom. The ancient kingdom was further south. And you see the layout of a ziggurat that has like a moat around it, where it actually sank sand and water collected, and the top is gone.
I found that fascinating because we never think in these terms. But, you know, archaeology and science, well, archaeology is a science, but archaeology and astronomy really do go hand in hand many times, and this is a perfect example. But I don't want to get you sidetracked because we only have about 12 minutes left before the break. So you were about to say that that goes hand in hand with the destruction that Lot and his family saw.
Right. Remember, Abraham left Babylon many years earlier and settled what we call Israel today, which is next to the Dead, where Lot settled in near the Dead Sea area. And they had two towns where they were each destroyed. Remember the recent item that came over Russia, that meteor?
Sure. Yeah.
And it exploded. And it was exploded above, around in the middle of about seven towns, and it exploded at a much higher altitude. And it was, they said it was around 20 times the size of Hiroshima. If it would explode closer to any of those towns, you'd have similar effects a lot during Solomon and Gomorrah. You'd have people vaporized even. And right. If you look at Lot, when he went around the mountain or town or wall, or whatever he was going around, that they were safe. It's not until she came back around after the second explosion, she was vaporized. And if you look at what the text says, it doesn't say God turned her to a pillar of salt. It's the descriptions of the people who went back to look for her said she was turned. What they saw was a shadow or an outline of her on the stone, just like we see today. You can go to the this Hiroshima site and see the shadow of people where they were standing. They were vaporized.
Right.
And the rock was bleached around them, except where their body was, it was still darkened.
Right. Right.
So that's a ancient description of a modern time event, if you want to call it that.
Okay. So we have that event in Sodom and Gomorrah. What other biblical events can you tie this to?
Joseph of Egypt, the drought, the Niebuhr disk in Germany gives us the year and month that it happened. For Joseph of Egypt.
Let's talk about that for a second, because one of the things that I gleaned from your book as I was going through it is the fact that there's this time period of 3.5 years of plenty and 3.5 years of drought. Now, that 3.5 years, and I want to get into this in the second part of the show, but the 3.5 years plays into this discussion. But what is it about drought that is associated with this event, with this heavenly body?
According to the physics, the stronger force in our universe is not gravity that's ruling our planets. It's electromagnetic in nature. And so we're seeing even Earth's field, electromagnetic field, being affected by some other body. It's moving at 12 times its normal rate in a northerly direction closer to our geographic north. And that's changing our jet streams, and that's changing our weather patterns and everything. But it's also greatly affecting the sun because of these magnetic fields or problems. So in the past history, we've had areas of 7 years of drought throughout the biblical records as well. And what you have is 3.5 years coming in of drought and 3.5 years as it's leaving. Remember in Revelation, it says when the two prophets arrive or witnesses that they will produce 3.5 years of drought on the world.
Right.
Where they come at the time that it's at its crossing of Earth's path. See, so you, as it's leaving, you get 3.5 years of drought. And this is the same drought that's during Joseph of Egypt, the same drought that's mentioned in the book of Ruth. There's a drought, there's 3 years of drought at the end of Saul's reign. There's 3 years again of drought at the beginning of David's reign. Now, they rounded numbers because they didn't have a word for half. So it was actually 3.5 and three and a half for the seven. And we have this multiple times throughout the Bible whenever you're looking. If you look for the hallmarks, you can find them. You're looking for drought, earthquakes. You're looking for a double eclipse, which is not normal. You also can look for a tilt or something that's representing a tilt of the earth. I found that the earth is tilted 26 to 28 degrees multiple times.
I was just going to say, you mentioned Joseph or Joshua, I should say, in your work and his long day. And also another event, I forget where it was. I think it was out of Hosea about a shadow. How do you relate those to this heavenly body?
Yes, if we look at the accounts, let's say, of Hezekiah. Well, Hezekiah gives an example where in the English it says the sundial moved backwards by 10 degrees. Well, when scientifically, that means the entire oceans would have covered the continents. But whenever you go back and read the Hebrew, it actually says it moved 10 steps. Well, because of the Niebuhr disk that also tells us that the earth tilted during Joseph's time, as it says in his dream, the skies bowed to him, all right? When he was 16, he had the dream. But when he was 40, it actually occurred, because we can say that about a Niebuhr disk. It says that the Niebuhr disk qualifies it, that's 26 to 28 degree tilt. We also have that in Hezekiah. When you take instead of a viewpoint from east to west, like on a sundial, and you change that from north to south, and that it was steps, the shadow moved on up and down 10 steps of a stairway facing south, you have exactly 26, 28 degrees again. And then that would make much more sense in a model. And we can prove that out in a model. When the tail of a, this object also has a tail similar to a comet. So if you, the best way to describe this is a planet slash comet, like a half breed of both. Well, when it gets between us and the sun, that means the tail is pointing at us because the tail always points opposite of the sun. And Earth enters into the tail, which is from the physics point of view, the tail is plasma. In an astronomy point of view, the tail is ice particles. Well, if it's ice particles, then we'll have no effect. But if it's plasma, as Earth is entering, you get an effect of Earth's rotation slowing down because the energy going into the north and south pole will be reduced by 4.5 to 5.5% compounded hourly. And it takes about 28 to 24 hours for Earth to come to a complete stop, as the text says in the long day of Joshua. And this model proves out. I brought the model to a physics professor. He took a few minutes to look at it, and he stated that I was the first one to ever explain this logically. We have a logical model, the eyewitness accounts of what they're showing. And there's other texts outside the Bible, which I still have to get my hands on, that's mentioned by Chuck Messler, as well as Emmanuel Velikovsky, that states that during this time period of Joshua's long day, him and his men saw an object 50 times larger than the moon. Again, when we use the same calculations, you put an object roughly 7 times the diameter of Earth halfway between the moon and Earth, you get a viewpoint from Earth of 50 to 1.
Right. Now, we're about 2 minutes from break. So what I want to do on the other side of the break is to begin to talk about some of the other evidence about Planet 7X. And then delve into some of the more technical and scientific issues regarding this. But audience, what we're trying to do is to build a foundation for you so that you understand why Mr. Burchard thinks the way he thinks. So with that, Gil, we have about a minute and a half before break. Are there any other biblical references that you want to briefly mention?
Well, there's another one of Jonah, Nineveh. Remember, Yeshua tells us that we'll have a sign in a wicked and adulterous generation. We'll only have one sign. And we read about the time about him being in a whale, but there's only 2 pages to Jonah. And what caught my attention to Jonah when he went to Nineveh, he didn't perform a single miracle.
But he said you have 40 days to repent, is what he told him.
Yes, he has 40 days. Well, the model shows us the only thing he had to do was point to the sky. And this is going to be a repeat event in the near future that the government will tell the public about in 40 days that this is a threat.
Well, that's, you know, audience, that's very interesting. I've said before that we've been prepped by the media, by the entertainment industry, and by our own government for some of the events that we see in science fiction movies today and regarding meteor impacts and that kind of thing. So I think Gil is spot on this. So we're going to delve deeper into this discussion and some of the other evidence that points to the heavenly body, Planet 7X, after this break. We'll be right back. Welcome back, audience. You are listening to Prepare the Way, and I'm your host, Daniel Holdings, with my very special guest, Gil Burchard, who is an independent researcher looking into the Planet X phenomenon, and he was gracious enough to be with us this evening. We are talking about all things Planet X, including, if you missed the first hour, some biblical references. You're going to have to catch that on the podcast in order to catch up, because there is very, very important information that will help you to understand the basics of this discussion and the reason why our guest thinks that we are about ready to be walloped once again by Planet 7X. So with that said, I need to remind you that this is a pre-recorded show, so therefore the phone lines aren't open. as we get back into this discussion, we spent the first half hour giving a general overview of Planet X, what the theory was behind it, other thoughts on it, and also went into some biblical reference why you believe that it is in fact a real phenomenon. You also mentioned that you thought it was a 360-year orbit around our sun, as opposed to some of the longer 3,600-year orbits, that sort of thing. And that you mentioned bore out by the evidence that the biblical evidence that you brought up. Now, what I'd like to do at the beginning of this half hour is to talk a little bit about other anecdotal evidence, perhaps not necessarily anecdotal, but evidence like non-biblical texts. You mentioned something in your book called the sky disk. What is it and why is it important?
Well, the sky disk is an ancient artifact found in Germany, and it's the oldest recorded pattern of the sky in Europe that we can find. I don't go along with the museum take on their description of it as far as the patterns and the dates. They list the Bronze Age, but when you take a close look at it, at some other eras, they had the it's a bronze disc that shows some gold inlay patterns across the sun, the moon, and the you see horizon. It's only about 12 inches or so across. What I noticed was that the moon was facing the opposite way, that side, not facing the sun, which the expert opinions did not catch. Two, that they were saying that it was an eclipse as a normal eclipse because the moon is shown to the right of it. It has to be a third object because the moon is shown in a crescent shape. You can only have an eclipse if it's a new moon, which is a full circle. And what's interesting about this mainly is that from their latitude, they're not able to see the constellation Monsieur Orion in the month of March as this constellation, as this pattern is framing. It's framing the constellation to the right, which is Capricorn, and the constellation to the left as Gemini. Then whatever patterns are in between there stating it. But that gives you the month March during the time period of 1794. And then what they could not see from that latitude was the constellation Orion, which is shown on the disk, unless the Earth tilted 26 to 28 degrees, and you had the viewpoint of the latitude of Luxor, Egypt, to be able to see this. And this object was created as well as found in Germany because the material finds of the object itself when it went to the laboratory show that it was mined from the local regions.
Okay, so we have this, and audience, I apologize, we're having some technical issues with Mr. Broussard's conversation here, but you can glean what he is saying. And again, please go to danielholdings.com. You can look at his book for yourself as you're following this discussion, because what he just said, he actually says in his book, so you'll be able to follow it. Now, and by the way, I should say, audience, that book is free. Mr. Broussard has put his time and effort into this work and made it available for free to the public at large because it's that important. He wants to get that information out. Excuse me. So, all right. So we have this disc. Now, is it me, Gil? Or does that sound like there was a polar shift? And for our audience's benefit, what is a polar shift?
Exactly that it refers that the poles have shifted to some Mr. degree. There's many people that take that and say it's 180 Mr. degrees. But there isn't any real hard evidence that it shifted 180 degrees because they get this from ancient texts. And it's from a viewpoint of Earth. And if someone would have seen stars from the, you see, horizon move to where it's above them, which is like 26 to 28 degrees, the words that they would have said that they would have thought the Earth is flipped, okay? But not 180 degrees. It's from their viewpoint on Earth. So it still matches the 26 to 28 degree tilt that's been mentioned. It's just the way you interpret text.
Right. And, you know, one of the things I always say, audience, and you've heard me say this, it's in my books as well, that, you know, how would ancient peoples describe events that we have science to describe now? They would describe it such as the stars bowed down, the sky was torn like a scroll, unfolded like a scroll. So these are the terms that ancient peoples used, and that's where we get these descriptions. Now, what exactly is a polar shift? Because there's such things as crustal displacement, and there's also a magnetic shift, but this isn't a magnetic shift. And what's the difference between the two, Gil?
Yes, magnetic poles are different from our geographic poles. We claim that the Earth had a magnetic shift several times. But going back, again, tracing back the original source of the data, was a gentleman that made the sketch that he put plus and minus marks. And what his original intent was that it was more or less strong of its normal fields. Not that it was a reversal of the fields, but that it was less than or equal to more than the present magnetic field strength. Now this one gets into the wrong hand, say, oh, the field's reversed. Look, minus and plus. But that's not what his original intention was. So that's how the whole 9 yards of 180 degree flipping of the magnetic poles come about. But I don't think there's real hard evidence to that, unless you're looking at lava, with lava flows in any direction, and it freezes in whatever its orientation as lava was made, you know, so therefore you can have different directions. So I'm not quite sure if the magnetic field is actually flipped as they claim. It might have, but I'm not real sure. Most evidence is referring to this serpent, the scientist, and he said he wished he never created the drawing because it's a misinterpretation. And the physical can document that three or four times where when this object gets close enough, they like two magnetic bar magnets. The opposite poles attract to each other, and they're going to tilt. The Earth would tilt towards it, 26 to 28 degrees, has been the common pole shift, if you wish to call it, or tilt that has happened in the biblical as well as other records.
When it comes to the polar shift and the tilting of the Earth, Gil, I seem to remember reading, in fact, my research actually brought this out, that there have been perturbations of other planets within our own solar system, i.e. the black spot, the spot on Jupiter, went crazy and then virtually went away. There was some very strange happenings on Mars. Is this all due to Planet 7X?
That's what I would attribute it to. Until the amateur astronomers, or according to my data, I believe our view is blocked by solar sail, but they can't block the effects. And for us to make this assumption fact, we have to see the object. But if you look at the hallmarks, earthquakes and volcanic activity is up 500% or greater. The weather patterns, you have bird and fish kills, which is the release of methane. It is the shifting of the crust that's causing all of this problems. Now, when you look outside weather patterns or earth or earthquake, well, we have the magnetic field of the Earth, which is being compressed, according to my opinion, and that's why it's moving at 12 times its normal rate, which is also what's affecting the sun. That's also showing these perturbations in the other planets. It's there's only one common denominator that answers all these questions at once. That's the inbound planet. And according to the model, it takes roughly 16 years from the edge of our universe for it to reach our sun. It's not immediate. It travels at a set rate, you know, that Kepler's law of the planetary move for a given mass of roughly seven times equal. I'm assuming that the mass, the density is similar to Earth. And with that, it would take 16 years. So it's from 1992, when I believe that they found it, which was roughly 8 years outside our solar system, that brings it around to this time, which the profile of the way things are escalating match.
Right. Well, you were, you know, that's interesting. You mentioned the 1992. I seem to recall reading a white paper on that very issue. But before we get there, you mentioned that there was some Chinese evidence, and we know that China has one of the oldest histories, one of the oldest cultures in the world. So what evidence were you alluding to when you spoke about the Chinese evidence?
Yes, there's a white paper report, and there's more than one of these by different authors pertaining to this, that in the last 10 years or so, they've did a re-evaluation of the supernova of 1054 as far as the text that came out of Asia. It appears that the supernova was spotted 4 or 5 months earlier in the text. And the text that is normally stated is been mischaracterized, because the white paper report clearly defines it, and the name of this white paper report is called the Reevaluation of the Eastern and Western Records of the Supernova 1054. This is done by the Dublin Institute of Advanced Studies. And what it's stating is this object moved through multiple constellations and was viewed for 26 months. Well, supernovas are stationary. It can't move in multiple constellations. So what was this large object that they viewed that they could see even in the daytime, represent, you know, as a tail and that type of thing? When we put a model, remember the software, astronomy software, it will bring me to that time, place, as it stated. I can go from Beijing. I've driven by the observatory of the Chinese of that period of time. I could place it on that elevation, that year, that day, month, and view the model as they viewed it at that particular time and see if it matches what they're misdescribing. And the model with the 150-day separation between entry and exit on the planetary plane of Earth matches each one of their accounts that they're describing by being near a star, at what elevation, what constellation, level of brightness. Again, one of the terms, at a given point, it was equal to the brightness of Venus, but as large as Jupiter. But when we look at the data, we can calculate that it's roughly one-third the size of Jupiter. You know, because it was closer, for it to be equal, the model showed us it was like one-third the distance from us, and therefore your visual perspective would have been equal to Jupiter, and that gives us roughly seven times the diameter of Earth again, which is multiple times we can find this data.
And that is no small object, folks. So what does all this mean? If, in fact, Gilbert-Shard is right, and we have an incoming celestial object, well, first, Gil, let me ask you, do you think this is what John in Revelation calls wormwood?
No, the wormwood is a asteroid that's part of the Mr. Debris field that's trailing this object. This is called the fiery dragon of old, or Baal, or the Mr. Destroyer. Wormwood is, if you ever look, go to the Smithsonian or any of the other museums that have actual steel asteroids of some type, and take a close look at it. It looks like wood that's been riddled by worms. It's all pitted in a way that's the first impression that you would get whenever you look at it. So it's a clear description of a meteor or asteroid hitting Earth, but it's a mountain-sized object.
Okay. Now, that said, you mentioned a wormwood being part of the debris field. We have about 10 minutes left of the program. So let's drill down to the nuts and bolts here. What can Earth expect if indeed this object is coming in to our atmosphere?
There's a planetary physics. Now, I don't have a crystal ball, but using Revelation 12:1 gives us a date of March 26, 2016. If it is that date, which I have no way of verifying unless we have a visual.
And why is that date? Why is that date significant?
Because they could not have guessed that date 2,000 years ago. 2,000 years ago for Passover, it would have been Libra. And they would have to know the pattern.
That's the point I'm getting at, that it is Passover, is it not?
Well, this date is exactly 3.5 days after the Feast of Passover, when Elijah is supposed to show up.
Right. And
it's impossible.
It's in the middle of the week of unleavened bread, as we are in the, as you know, audience, we are in the week of unleavened bread, and that we're honoring that out of the Torah. Now, when we talk about those things that we can expect with this coming, you mentioned in your book something about a meteor shower. Why is this significant, and what can we expect from it?
If this data is correct, then it passes again, similar to all of the stories I'm finding out are data points, giving us the data we need to understand Revelation as far as CO6 and 7. This object is going to pass again between the moon and the Earth again. Earth would tilt again, just like it did in Hezekiah. And it will also, you'll have a 12-hour delay. And about an hour later, you're entering a meteor shower, which is the debris field behind us. The object doesn't hit us, it misses us, but we go into the debris field. Now, prior to that, we're entering the plasma field that causes us to rotate and slow down by 12 hours. So the anticipated target zone will be off by 12 hours, which is exactly half of the Earth, you know, in its rotation. And Revelation is describing North and South America. It says one-third of grass and trees, and later it says rivers. Well, that's describing continental crust. There's only half of the globe that has one-third of the continental crust is North and South America.
So are you saying, Gil, that North and South America are going to get walled by a fiery meteor shower when this happens?
Yes, it also fulfills part of what the Father said. It says, you shall not make new life. You shall not create new life. North and South America is the only continents that have GMO, genetically modified crops. He's going to destroy this new life form that he says we are forbidden to make. There's a reason why all the trees and grass and crops are burnt. And he says, move out the way. His people will know to leave, you know, to go. We're supposed to follow a Mikra to be in Jerusalem every year to start out with. So during that Mikra, we're in Jerusalem fulfilling Passover.
Okay, so we're We are, and I hate to cut you off, but we're running out of time here. We're almost at the end of the program. We got about 5 minutes left of the program. So where would you say that this body is right now? Where do you think it is?
Roughly year 2000, it entered our solar system. In year 1992, NASA made instrument contact with it. That's why they went silent after they used to have articles and magazines printed that were looking for this. 92, they went totally silent on it. But when you take this date in Revelation and reverse the model, it brings us to where it's right between Voyager and Pioneer probes. Okay? Yes, we have four scientific studies. Two of them are showing the orbits of comets are warped. We have the Chinese data. There's two studies on that. We have actual where NASA sent probes. And there is 88 constellations. And all the scientific data and the biblical data are pointing to only one constellation. That constellation is Sagittarius, and not just randomly anywhere in that, but on the ecliptic. The odds of this is like winning the lottery 10 times in a row. It does not happen. We have scientific studies showing comets are warped by unknown gravity in that region of space. When you have gravity, you have to have a large body like a planet to do that type of warping of their path. You see?
So, okay. We have that evidence. Does this evidence point to you where this object is, because we only have a couple minutes left in the show, where this object is and when, here's the question, audience, when will we be able to see it if it indeed exists?
I believe that for them to hold control over the people, they have to start a Middle East war prior to us viewing the object, and they have to shut down the internet so 2 to 3 million amateur astronomers that can measure this item with their optics. They say, whoa, this is not a comet, this is much bigger. For them to silence them, they have to silence the internet, and they have to use the war to do this. So when you see a war happening about mid of the way, look up towards Sagittarius, you'll see a comet-like object on the ecliptic. That's when we'll see it. And they'll probably happen anywhere between 6 to 9 months prior to its arrival. And that's what I'm expecting.
And when do you think that arrival will be?
Possibly after September. After the last blood moon, sometime after that, between there and the following March, which is Passover, sometime within it, keep an eye in the sky. The biblical records tell us we must see a sign in the sky. Now we know what to look for. He says we won't see it first. We're going to see the effects of it. Well, read the signs. They're in front of you. You have escalation of volcanic activity, earthquake, fish and bird life dying. We have the magnetic north. We have the sun acting up. And we have perturbation of comets and planets. Anybody with any sense that has science background say we have a problem. These are the signs. Now, to a wicked and adulterous generation, they will ignore the signs. So I say to people, wake up.
So, all right, we are staring down the barrel of a very dangerous gun. We have about a minute and a half left, Gil. What, aside from telling people to wake up, what would you suggest they be doing right now?
Well, prior to the Smita, we're in the Smita, but if you haven't prepared the way the Bible or Scripture tells you to do, on the sixth year, you store up food for the seventh year. And the seventh year, the fields are open to the poor for them to gather their grain to have a storehouse for that year. So there's a period of time where the poor are still gathering their foods, but expect hard times during the Smita to happen. You're looking at CO3, economic collapse, CO4, war, and pandemic disease and famine, and in 5, which is the peace agreement. That's why these souls on the altar are complaining. Where is our pound of flesh? He's saying it's not your time. Go back to sleep. CO6 is the beginning of the Great Tribulation, which starts with a meteor shower from our planet. And CO7 is 5 months later.
Well, it will be a very interesting year at the end of this year. I think so. Audience, you recall I had Pastor Mark Biltz had spoke about the hazards of this upcoming blood moon, and here's more evidence that this is no ordinary year. Gil Broussard, I thank you so much for being on with us. Do me a favor, brother, and give out your information again, your YouTube channel information, that sort of thing.
Sure. On YouTube, just type in Planet 7X to view the data and the way the math and the science is working out, and how there is a scientific model of the biblical accounts. Remember, science is when you take observed phenomenon, bring it to the laboratory, and show that it's repeatable. That is science. Now we have a model that proves out the biblical accounts. And this proves out in 1485, it was a jubilee when they entered the land. As they said, first year would be a jubilee. This is 70 jubilees in 2016. This will be the 70th jubilee.
All right, and that will need to be the last word on a very poignant program. Gilbert Sarr, thank you so much for being with us, brother. I've thoroughly enjoyed the time, and perhaps we can talk again. Folks, again, if you want to listen to, or that is, look at the information that Gil has available, either go to his YouTube channel, or you can go to danielholdings.com and take a look at his PDFs there. That'll be it for this week on Prepare the Way. I'm your host, Daniel Holdings. Next week, we will have L.A. Marzulli speaking about The Watchers, his latest project, and all the things that are going on at the end of the age. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next week. Shalom. So, you know, I've done some research as well, obviously, for my books. However, this man has the inside skinny, as they say, on what is going on, and we're going to delve into that in just a moment. But before we do that, Gil, we need to set some information up for the listeners, some foundation, so that they understand what we are talking about. Now, I have heard it said that Planet X's or Nibirus or the Destroyer or Wormwood, however you want to call it, many names, as you said, it goes by. That the orbit of it around the sun is A, elliptical, and B, that it is a 3,600-year orbit or something like that. So what exactly is an elliptical orbit, and what do you think that the orbit actually is?
Planetary bodies normally have a elliptical orbit, but it's more in a circular shape around the star. Slender or very tight elliptical orbits are usually pertaining to comets or asteroids or something similar to that. But this object that we're talking about for the first time, this is going to be redefining some of our definitions in astronomy. This is a planet-sized object that has a very slender elliptical orbit, roughly about 150 days apart on its entry and exit, between 150 and 152. The modern time frame would be about 152 days. And that's what's so astounding. Without the records, the Asians in the year 1054, that they actually saw the object and gave us enough accurate data that we could actually plot it. So that started it off.
So I want to get to that data in just a few minutes. But for the audience's sake, when it comes to you don't believe that the orbit around in our solar system around the sun is 3,600 years, do you?
No, that's where there's no data actually backing that. Because when you're dealing with ancient languages, keep in mind that zeros were misimplied. So to get 3,600 years, you got quite a few zeros in there that would indicate that 3,600 year orbit are found to be false. I think it mostly started with Stichen. The ancient Sumerians had a unit of 60. And so if you would have did 60 times 60, you'd have 3,600. But if you would have multiplied 60 times 6, it's 360. With an even, that's 150 days apart. And if you listen closely to it, in the description, the way the floodgates of heaven opened up, that's not a normal rain. And at the end of it, at 150 days, there was a great wind that passed over the water before he saw the water to recede. There was two major events, 150 days apart. Well, that's also qualified in Revelation. It talks about these two events, CO 6 and 7, and it says 5 months they'll wish death, but death will not come. Well, 5 months in a biblical term and 150 days is equal, just about equal. It could be 150 to 152 days. And I kind of look at that through astronomy as possibly a meteor shower as an entry and an exit point of an object that's on the planetary plane of Earth that's crossing Earth's path twice. So if that assumption, if we go with that, now we have three fixed points, not two, because the other fixed point is the sun. So that puts an object that's exactly on the planetary plane of Earth for it to cross Earth's path 5 months apart for such an event.
Right.
And then what other qualifiers we have is, if you look at Yeshua's sacrifice, well, there was a 3 hours of darkness that even Otzi text and other books says the whole Earth was darkened.
And why is that significant? I mean, people say, well, it could have been an eclipse of the sun.
Because mainly Passover is held on a full moon. You cannot have eclipse of the sun in a full moon state.
That's right.
The moon has to be 180 degrees on the opposite side of Earth in a new moon state to block the sun.
Well, and on top of that, I don't ever recall an eclipse lasting for 3 hours.
Correct. An eclipse only lasts around 7.3 minutes at max. And the biblical and the outside text says both the moon and the sun were eclipsed. You have a double eclipse. You cannot have a double eclipse at the same time because one causes the other. You can only have one at a time. So it's actually defining through, if you look at it through astronomy eyes, it's defining a third object that's many times larger. And throughout other events, we came out, and that's how we got the object being anywhere between 6.5 to 7.5 times the diameter of Earth that causes a 3-hour eclipse.
Wow. That's, and you know, audience, this is the first time I've heard this. One thing I want to go back to very quickly, Gil. People have said that Nibiru was a brown dwarf star. That is a star, audience, that hasn't fire that doesn't have a hydrogen reaction. So, but it's very heavy in gravity and mass.
Which some of it's, this has a, you see, erratic orbit if it's not hitting or bumping into things. But for the most part, it has somewhat of a 360-year orbit.
Okay,
in general.
Let's define terms here for the audience, because many people in the audience may not know about Planet X. They probably read about Wormwood in the Bible. However, they may not know about Planet X and the history behind it and the discussion from the various so-called experts. Who is Sitchin? What is Sitchin?
I'm not quite sure what his title was, but he interpreted some ancient clay tablets.
Sumerian text, was it not?
Right. Sumerian text from the, clay tablets. But when you're dealing with ancient language, zeros are implied again. And so evidence is when you can start with text that is qualified by multiple people who interpret it, saying this is what it says. So then your basis is sound. Whatever
conclude
for that. No one backed up Sitchin's misinterpretations who are able to read the Sumerian text.
The point is that Sitchin, I forget his name, Carl Sitchin. Carl Sitchin was he's an occultist. But there have been numerous individuals that have taken his information and ran with it. The circular reasoning, just as you mentioned a little bit ago. And this is why I bring this up, because if you put junk into a computer, you'll get junk out of a computer. So it's really important.
Correct.
we start with a sound foundation, and that's why I don't want to delve too long into Sitchin, but that's why, audience, we needed to go there. So you know who this person is, where some of this, there are various experts out there that are talking about it. One of the people that I found most credible is, you're listening to him now, Gil Broussard, because of the information where the information is that he has taken it from. So this is really, really important, and that's why we are talking about these things that we are. So with that said, Gil, there are, you said that it was a 360-year orbit, you believed. So why do you say that biblical events do you see in Scripture that point to associated heavenly body entering in our solar system?
Well, we have multiple, probably close to 12. One of them, what caught my attention was in two main stories. Noah's flood states, well, thank you. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. We are very excited. You know, Gil, one of the things that I've tried to do in my writing, and I, you know, my listeners know that I am an author and that I write fiction thrillers. And one of the things in my last book that I actually happened to mention was Planet X. But Planet X actually goes by many different names. And so I was very excited when you and I had the opportunity to talk and to get you on the air for our listeners, because, audience, the show is Prepare the Way, as you know. And we talk about those things that are coming upon the earth in preparation for our coming Messiah, the second coming of our Messiah. So it is important that we look at these things with eyes wide open. Some of the things that Gil will talk about today will absolutely blow you away. But audience, I challenge you, look at the information, look at the evidence, look at the data before you make up your mind. Because it is astounding the kind of things that this man has to say, and it is my pleasure to have him on the show this evening. Now, Gil, what is Planet X, and what other names does it go by?
Well, it goes by probably 80 different names throughout different cultures. You've heard it as either Zeus or Jupiter or Baal or Nibiru and several other ones. And that's associated with the time and culture. That's the only reason why the name is changed.
But you know, when you talk about Planet X, you actually don't call it Planet X. What do you call it?
I call it Planet 7X because we know the size now. And secondly, it's a separated data on where the information is coming from. There's some people that are have story, I call it, of Planet X, but there's no data backing it that I could find. It started really from a circular reasoning that one person said it, then it's misrepeated. But when you go back to find the root and where the evidence is and the data, it's lacking. And so I was a hardened skeptic pretty much on the whole topic. For about a year and a half, there was no evidence backing any. There was threads of truth, it sounded like, from some of the storylines of the ancient people's accounts. But that's about as much as I would give it at the point. There was no evidence to say when, the size, any of this, until I found my own evidence pertaining to that.
So that's what thrust you on this journey. How long have you been researching Planet X7X?
3.5 years.
3.5 years.
After I found some hard evidence, then that caused me to do a very deep study in it.
Well, in audio...
Signs in the heavens and signs in the earth. Nation rising up against nation and man's love waxing cold. At the center, the two branches of Israel coming together as one, all pointing to the return of the great king, soon but not yet. Prepare the Way is a program which looks at issues of the day that mainstream media ignores. We face the truth head-on in a world that is determined to tear itself apart. Leading the discussion today is your host, author Daniel Holdings. Phone lines will be open later in the program so you can join the discussion. Now let's prepare the way.
Well, good evening, Hebrew Nation. This is your host, Daniel Holdings, and you are listening to Prepare the Way. We have an information-packed hour with you as I speak with expert Gil Broussard about Planet X. But before we get to that, a brief programming note. Of late, I know that many of you have wanted to call in and have a dialogue with me. However, this show is pre-recorded, and the reason for that, obviously, is because my guest needed to be available now and not at the normal airing time of the show. We will hopefully get to do a live broadcast very soon. Now, before we get started, you need to know something. My website is www.danielholdings.com. The reason I tell you that is because my guest's information is on that website. So if you are by your computer, you need to click on your little mouse there and open up that website so that you can begin to peruse the information that Gil has put on the website, because it is pertinent to the discussion that we are having, and you will find it difficult to follow it. So please take the time to go to the website and to bring it up and take a look at the information so that you can follow the discussion. Now, my guest this evening is Gil Broussard. Gil is out of south of Lafayette, Louisiana. He's a Louisiana boy, and he's an independent researcher, an amateur astronomer, and he is a tenacious individual. He was a former engineer in the oil and gas industry that's given him the ability and access to visit many places in the world, as well as talk to individuals that you and I may never get to talk to. So it is with that background that I bring on to you today our guest, Gil Broussard. Gil, welcome to Prepare the Way.